your boyfriend now, Nancy. This is God. Hey, Nancy. No running in the hallway. Hey, folks. Kilt-Kruger here. Kilt-Kruger.
Folks, yes, it's me. It's me all along, running your dreams. A dream to some. A nightmare to others. Right, now. Yes, I've been promising to do this mask review for quite some time now. I know. Let me just get this wicked bloody thing off, because it'll be a very short video if I don't slit my own throat. Isn't that a fantastic prop, that one? I did do a video on this a couple of weeks ago, and it's a custom-made job, and it's absolutely bloody brilliant. I'll have you know. Fred Krueger. Yeah, now, there's a million and one masks for Freddy, you know? And the vast majority of them are a load of shit. Don't worry, I'll talk you through that in a bit. But, that is the official Ruby's mask for Nightmare on Elm Street. There's the little tag that came with it. Yeah. Official one. To be honest, it's quite hard to get hold of a mask, a really good mask from the original movie. There's a lot that come out from the rest of the franchise, and there's subtle variations on them. And to be honest, most of them are a load of shit. They really are. I've never been impressed by the Freddy mask. That one. Look, we need to get some stuff inside that so you can see the shape of it. Bags. Mucho baggage. Because Robert Englund, who plays Freddy, possibly trained that bit. But he's got like a gargoyle face anyway. This, by the way, is Charles Bernstein's awesome score. One of my favourite horror scores of all time. It's just incredible. And I've done a video on this as well previously. Let's see if we can get this on here now. There's some semblance of shape to it. There you go, that's not too bad. Now, he has the face of a gargoyle imp type creature anyway, you know, even without any makeup on him. So it wasn't hard stretch, hard push to make him look like the burned visage of the nightmare demon that is ex-child molester, paedophile, killer, Freddy Krueger. And do you know where they got Freddy Krueger from? Wes Craven, who had done Last House on the Left, Hills of Eyes 2, and Deadly Friend, and Deadly Blessing, and then come up with the genius that was this movie. And then, of course, he went off to Scream, because all this went to his head, and he thought, like, I can reinvent horror. And as much as Scream,
this
you know,
is God.
As much as Scream did kind of reinvigorate the stalk and slash genre, it was far too up its own arse to be taken seriously by people like me who were genuine, bona fide, dyed-in-the-wool gore hounds and horror aficionados. It was just too self-referential. Nightmare on Elm Street was the perfect example of going from stalk and slash to pure imaginary fantasy horror and really, really trippy out hallucinogenic sort of visuals. Clever idea. The name Fred Krueger came from a guy that used to bully Wes Craven. He used to beat him up, so he changed it to Freddy Krueger. Also, one of the main villains in his first film, the experimental and horribly brutal Video Nasty, which is a film I vowed I'd never watch again after seeing it the first time because it was just so cruel and horrible. And not a horror film, it was just torture porn, basically. The lead killer in that, David Hess, played a guy called Krueger, you know, so he just extended it. Also, the basis of the red and green jersey, apparently the human eye, when confronted by those two particular colours, finds it very hard to accept it. It doesn't like it. so it's an unpleasant image to begin with. The battered fedora, and you know, this sort of, the way that Freddy knows what you're thinking, and he's ahead of you every step of the way, and he taunts you. The genesis for this, for Nightmare on Elm Street and Freddy Krueger, was born out of two things. A spate of suicides by mainly Southeast Asian refugees who had come to America and were suffering from nightmares and dream sleep disorders. They refused to go to sleep, and they were killing themselves, or they simply wouldn't wake up. And Wes Craven spotted all these similarities in different cases and thought, there's something going on here. But also, the thing about the way that Freddy looks, and the cackling intent, the hat, the jersey, you know, the disheveled look. When he was a kid, Wes Craven heard something on the street outside the apartment block where they lived. He looked out the window, and you can imagine how horrifying this would be. There is a down and out, or a drunk, looking the way that Freddy Krueger looks, looking straight up at him, right into his eyes, like he knew this kid was going to suddenly appear at the window. So young Wes Craven recoils in shock, hides in the shadows, waits for ages, hears nothing, goes back to the window. Motherfucker's still there, smiling up at him, because he knew, you know, you're going to come back and look again, so I'm going to wait here for you. Oh, you can imagine the fucking shock of that, like. And then this Krueger prototype walks backwards down the street, you know, looking all the time and smiling up at the young Wes Craven. And then Wes Craven realises that, hang on a second, he's going around the corner there. The only thing around the corner is the entrance to our apartment block. So he runs and wakes his brother up, gets the baseball bat. There's a similarity there to the film Nightmare on Elm Street, where Nancy Thompson, played by Heather Langenkamp, gets the young Johnny Depp, you know, the awesomeness that is Johnny Depp, who's a bit wasted in this, obviously. You're a jock, you have a bat. When I bring him back through my nightmares, back into the real world, you clock him. You've got a baseball bat. So there you go. He sends his brother out with the baseball bat, because they've heard the door open and footsteps on the steps coming up to their floor. But when he goes out, there's no one there. Whoa! So you can see how this played a part in the whole genesis of the creation of Freddy Krueger as a villain. And also the concept of, you know, dreams being a dangerous battleground, that, you know, once you're in that dream world, if someone can manipulate it, then you're fucking stuck there, aren't you? There's not much you can do about that. Absolute classic movie.
Hey, Nancy! No running in the hallway.
It's just genius, isn't it? The fedora, by the way, this fedora here is not a fedora. This is actually a campaign hat worn by, and stamped as well, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. Can you see that? The RCMP. Now, I got a couple of these, which is why I didn't mind knackering this one up, but I haven't got the fedora. So, I was trying to. They're very stiff, these hats. So, you know, if you're going to do it, get the proper bloody hat, you know, but I didn't have it to hand, so I'm trying to fold it down. And the Montana Peak is four indentations on the peak, but of course the fedora only has the two, so if I squash that in, you know, it's just for effect. Let's get back to this baby here. Rubies made the mask. A fella called, I'll go up to his name, David Miller designed the makeup for Robert Englund. So, you know, you've got the, it's a margarita pizza, isn't it? You know, that's basically what it is. Now, forgive the fact that there's the white plastic bag that's in there. This is actually, although a cheaply made, mass-produced mask, it's not bad at all. As I said, most of the ones I've seen have been bloody rubbish. This, at least, has the look of Freddy. That vicious nose on him. Those horrible mangled teeth. That's actually very accurate to the imagery of him. I know, I've looked. And before you start going, well, it's a bit pale, isn't it? You know, the mozzarella and the tomato, you know. The thing is, in a lot of sequences in the film, when you see him without the hat on, he does look very, until he gets burned again at the end, it is kind of very pale. So that's authentic as well. Plus, what I like about it, they've done the folded over here. It's right here. It's slightly more disheveled than the other one. In fact, I think the bit's hanging off the bottom, you know, the lobe as well, but they haven't done those. but they have managed to address the fact that one ear is more deformed than the other one. So it's not a bad mask. The detailing on it, the contours, you know, they're really good. They're really, really good. I will, at some point, probably shade in a fair bit of this, the paler aspect of this. That's maybe just for my personal taste, you know. But that is a great mask. Rubies got the official license for it. Rubies do it. I've done a lot of Rubies reviews actually lately. And in fact, there's something coming as well. I've always got something else coming, haven't I? Always. And that's a Rubies mask as well. They ain't saying what it is though. But it's a doozy. But yeah, I think that's a really wonderful visage. You can see Robert Englund there. That snarl, that sneer on his face. The brutish look. The demonic sort of, you know, contempt that he has. It's all there. It's all captured in that mask, in that visage. And I really like it. You know. It is. It looks tasty. I want to actually eat it, you know. Bit of black pepper, you know. Bit of parmesan. But back to the movie again. The creation of Freddy Krueger as well.
To Freddy.
There he is again. You know, in the first movie, which is a bona fide masterpiece, he is one of the most sadistic creations that you're going to find. Not only was he a child killer, a paedophile, but he comes back to kill, get revenge on the kids, the parents that, you know, incinerated him. And he taunts them. And he's got a very mean-spirited streak. There's not many one-liners in the first movie. Okay, you've heard a couple there. I'm your boyfriend now, Nancy. And the tongue comes out the third. And it goes like that. But he has just killed her boyfriend. So it isn't just like a little throwaway disposable line, which every other movie in the franchise would just derail their narrative with. Freddy would become a parody of himself. He'd become a caricature. And Robert Englund, who, you know, classically trained actor, up until this point, I mean, he'd been in a couple of like horror movies, only sort of bit parts, but his big break was in the TV show V, the sci-fi invasion movie V, and he was the friendly alien, wasn't he? Sort of. And, you know, his curly hair as well, like, his little face, you know, he looked almost cherubic, but when that face stops smiling, and he puts that steely look in his eyes, he becomes that. And that is the mark of a really good actor. He can transform his own bloody face to fit the role. And he danced as well with the glove. He used the glove as a major prop. It's like a spider in the film. It comes into different parts of the frame and it skitters around with its fingers, you know, its claws. Of course, the scraping on steel. You know, it's designed to go through you, isn't it? You know. But the way he taunts his victims, he laughs. He's chasing Tina at the start, and in a clever move, Wes Craven sort of builds her to be the main star of the movie. He's kind of following her more than anybody else, and then she gets killed. It's a pure Janet Leigh character from Psycho. You're following her, and then shock of shock, she gets off. Then you've got to follow another bunch of characters, and he does it brilliantly well. And Tina, you know, watch this. And he cuts his fingers off and they're all squared. This is God. And he cuts his chest open and all that. But the imagery that he puts into people's dreams is truly phantasmagorical, which is a great word, but also truly horrific and disturbing. You know, Tina's body and the body bag, you know, and the big beetle comes out of the mouth and she's scraping the inside of the plastic, you know, Nancy. It's just taunting its victims. There's so many horrible assumptions and insinuations made. When her mother, Nancy's mother, actually says, like, you know, he chased into an old boiler room where he used to take his kids. He used to take his kids. He took their fucking kids, you know? But you're giving him more power. And that's the clever conceit of the movie. Everybody around is giving Freddy more and more power. Okay, you've got the bizarre ending, I know. You know, like, she's killed him a couple of times. She built all those traps. Daddy, I want you to come back in exactly 20 minutes, break down the door and come and get me, because I'm going to pull him through out of my dream into the real world, and you can arrest him then. baby, and the great John Saxon, you know, as the police lieutenant, you know, he's like, baby, I'll be there. Just promise me, Daddy, 20 minutes. That'll be exactly 11:30. In that 20 minutes, she goes, there's a big heart-to-heart with her mum, who's sozzled again, like, I love you, mum, and all this. Like, don't worry about a thing, baby. You know, and then she builds all these fucking traps in 20, and then goes to sleep, and goes into REM sleep in 20 minutes. The great way to get around that is the fact that you don't know what's a dream and what isn't. And that's when you go back to and watch the movie again, and again and again and again, you, all the bits you think, oh, this is reality now, it's unraveled by that, some would say, a ludicrous shock ending. But it does work in the grand concept of dreams within dreams and not knowing at what point reality begins again. And it's just genius. Wes Craven always made a thing about the differing standards of families. If you look at, like, Last House on the Left, this gang of outlaws kidnapped two girls, and he wind up and he tortured and murdered them and raped them. And then they go back and they end up at the house, the last house on the left, which is the parents of one of the girls, finds that they're bloody clothes, and then he and his wife exact revenge upon this gang with chainsaws and, you know, and other methods, which we won't go into right here. But and then obviously The Hills Have Eyes pits, you know, a family, you know, Midwest family against the hillbilly rednecks who live out in the desert, you know, the Arizona desert, and they're just cannibals, and they're differing values. So the civilized person becomes a monster to try and survive the evils of an already evil, you know, antagonist family. And again, the same thing's here in Nightmare on Elm Street. He does explore it again, because you've already got the parents who, like, you know, it was bad when we didn't know who it was, but it was even worse when we found out and they arrested him. But why didn't they send him down, Mummy? You know, well, the lawyers got rich and the judge got famous, but someone forgot to sign a search warrant in the right place, and that thing, he was out. A bunch of his parents followed him to his boiler room warehouse, and we torched the place. So normal civilized people then act in a barbaric fashion, and wholly justified. Pedos should be incinerated. Am I wrong? No, I'm not. And so he's juxtaposing, you know, the better off, the well-to-do classes suddenly turning sadistic and primal to combat an already primal force, which is on the outside attacking them. But it just gives Freddy the strength to come back from the grave and invade their dreams. Lots of religious allegory as well, and imagery, where Freddy's arms stretch long, he's in the cruciform position, and his claws are scratching on the walls. You know, this is God, you know, and all this, and the resurrection, the whole thing about coming back from, you know, the grave. There's a lot of imagery there. The crucifix on the wall, when the great scene when Nancy's asleep, and the crucifix bounces off the wall, picks it up, knocks the wall, goes back to sleep again, and he comes out the wall, like that. Speaking about coming out of things, even though I was an absolute diehard fan of horror movies since I was about that fucking big, and I'm only that big now, I've seen the most shocking movies, I've seen the scariest movies, the most disturbing movies, and I've survived them all. I've got a few scars from, but one that really got me was this. I remember going with a gang of us who went to flicks, and I knew all about the film. I'd read Fangoria and lots of Starburst magazines. I knew the film was coming, and I was the one telling everyone else, oh, this is going to be awesome, you're going to love this. It fucking put me in a state of shock, absolute trauma. You know, that scene where she runs up the stairs and her feet are going in, sinking into the stairs, and he comes through the little window and the door, help, save me from, and this mask comes up and it's his face, Freddy. And she gets into her room, and Glenn, Johnny Depp's supposed to wake up when he sees her having trouble in her sleep. He's fucking conked out, like. And she shuts her bedroom door, and she's got a mirror on the inside of the door. Shuts the door, and she's going like, this is just a dream. It isn't real. It's just a dream. He isn't real. He isn't real. And at that moment, he goes, fucking right through the door and through the mirror. Oh, Jesus. It took me a week and a half to come down from the ceiling of the fucking cinema. Oh, God. I mean, you've had shocks of plenty. Ben Gardner's head coming through the hole in the boat in Jaws. Yep, classic. You know, plenty of it. Michael Myers, coming out the shadows, loads of stuff, you know. But that really put me in a state of trauma. But it's even more subtle moments than that, which are equally as powerful. When her mother takes her to the clinic for dream disorders, this is a great scene, this, because it's so understated and yet so powerful. You don't see Freddy. She doesn't want to be put to sleep because she knows what's going to happen. No, and they convince her, no, this will be good for you. They're going to study what happens. Don't worry. There's a doctor here and a nurse over there. Don't you worry. They put all these little electrodes and, you know, monitors on her. And then she goes into sleep. And the doctor's brilliant, you know. He just goes in. And she's here. She's going into rapid eye movement now. The dream now will be like 3 or 4. A nightmare will be 5 or 6. On this little readout. And they've got them drawing in the little lines on the paper, you know, all the monitors and all that. Like, and next thing, she starts convulsing. But you don't see what her dream is. But you hear the claws scratching. And you hear, because that's what she's experiencing. And then, like, next thing, she's like, she's booking about on the bed, pure, you know, Linda Blair, Reagan, Exorcist style. And the mother's going like, doctor, what's happening? And he's going, you can't make it out, because suddenly the score's gone to 20, 30, even more. And he's got a nightmare now, it'll be 5 or 6. You're like, oh, fucking hell. So they go in there, and they wake her up, and she's pulled the hat through. But not only that, he's cut her with the claws. She's got a big gaping slash wound across her forearm. Now, this is the thing, you know, in reality, if you were that scientist and the nurse there, and she's pulled a hat through from a fucking dream, you're going, you aren't going anywhere, we're going to study you, you're staying right here. We ain't never seen this kind of shit before, you know. But it's a genius sequence, so unnerving in its subtlety, in a way. And I love the way that later on, as she's waiting to set her traps and bring him out once and for all, and the clock's ticking and she's waiting, the wound begins to bleed again. Like, Nancy, Hedda Langenkamp, gives a tremendous performance. She's one of the best, you know, last girls, or one of the best, in fact, I'm doing a disservice by saying that, you know, last girls. She's a great performer and a great character in a role that she totally and utterly owns. In the air, you know, the whole Me Too, you know, furore at the moment, you know, equality and all this, and better roles for women in movies, and everyone cites, well, you had it years ago with, you know, Sigourney Weaver as Ripley, a woman that fought back. Yeah, you did. But people forget about Nancy. Nancy's proactive. She goes out and hunts him. She taunts him back. She builds these fucking traps. Man, she is a force to be reckoned with. You know, and I tremendously, you know, I back her. I totally believe her. And hey, you know, Glenn, you shit. You bastard. You know, you're supposed to wake me up, you know. And he's like, sorry. And of course, you've got his famous death scene. Poor Johnny Depp gets pulled down into the bed. And altogether, too much blood for the human being comes fountaining upwards. Of course, the second scene in the movie where they use a room built which can tilt on a gimbal. First time you see Tina being dragged up the wall and getting her gut slashed open. And you're like, and she's screaming so horribly as well. And she goes up the wall and along the ceiling. And you're like, what the fuck? It's just incredible. And then obviously the Glenn's room, the whole room is built upside down, basically. And if you watch, there's a secret that the mother comes, because she's heard the screams and a fountain of blood, and she comes in and just sees this torrent of, you know, this tsunami, this upside down waterfall of blood hitting the ceiling. But if you look at that sequence, there's a moment where, and it's quite well documented, the room is turned at an angle, so the camera captures and the blood's flying off the lampshades and the bedstead on an angle, and it looks really weird. It wasn't meant to be like that, but it just looks even more convincing as this kind of otherworldly effect. You're like, oh my god. So it's accidents like that that happen on set which really, you know, contribute. And speaking of accidents on set, you know, the poor guy, I think his name is Caesar, who was the stuntman who does the burn scene when Nancy's trapped Freddy down in the basement and he's going around one side of the stairs and she's got, like, you know, kerosene or whatever. Chucks it over and he's going, no, no, because obviously he's been burnt before. And then she lights him up. That's a long shot of him. Okay, he's quite clearly bulked up in a burn suit, but the makeup's like this. that takes nothing away from the fact that he's totally engulfed in flames. And he comes around the stairs, he chases her up the stairs, he goes up the top of the stairs, she knocks the door into him, he tumbles back down the stairs. This is all, there's a couple of cuts in it, but in reality, he filmed the whole sequence like this. And up to that point, it was the longest ever sustained burn effect, burn stunt, that ever been filmed. He goes up the stairs again, and then he collapses on the stairs. And then if you just see the making of, a split second after the camera zooms in on his burning body, they come in with, you know, fire extinguishers and put him out. Fucking hell, you know. Things people do. And same, it's just like, oh, was that okay? Do you want to go again? Fuck that, you know. And, but I love the movie. The glove was designed by, oh God, I forgot the guy's name now. Oh, what was it now? Jim Doyle. I did write that down. Jim Doyle designs the glove. And it's meant to look homemade, customised. It's meant to be a mess, a ramshackle mess. And you see this baby here, it's got blood stains on it as well. Like, beautiful, beautifully done. It's clumsily done because in the opening montage, you see the construction of the glove. And you hear his breathing as well. So you already know this guy is like fucking not right. And then, you know, he's going to kill kids with that? Yeah, it is. I find the film immensely shocking and powerful, but totally grueling bravura and really exciting. I'm not massively fussed on the conclusion that ends the movie, where, you know, everything was a dream and the mum was okay. You know what? I'm going to stop drinking now. I just don't want to anymore. And they get in the car, and all the kids are back from the grave. Johnny Depp's back there, Tina's back, and Rod, who's the delinquent lunatic, Rod. Rod's not a lunatic, Dad. He's the one that gets strangled in the jail cell. But they're all back in the car, and of course, the canopy comes over, and it's red and green stripes. And then the mother gets dragged through the door again. It's clearly a doll, but, you know, it's not a nice shocking effect. But the original ending would have had, you know, they get in the car and Nancy turns around and it's Freddy driving the car. In all honesty, I think that'd be more effective than the doll coming through the thing. But, and then the sort of hazy image of the school kids on the skipping rows. 1, 2, Freddy's coming for you. Of course, the film was a massive rip-roaring success for a low-budget movie and it spawned an enormous amount of sequels. Most of which are absolutely dire. Because I said before, they turned Freddy into a fucking cartoon caricature of himself. He no longer was a threat. His taunts were pathetic. His one-liners, oh, they were just shit. It was just corny. Just cheeseballs. You cheapened him. Massively cheapened him. I know there's a lot of fans for Nightmare on Elm Street 3 Dream Warriors. And it has its moments. I mean, it has the nicely done backstory to him by the nun who's meant to be his mother, meant to be his mother, who was locked inside this, you know, the lunatic ward over the summer holidays, like, and she was raped, you know, a gazillion times, and she spawns Freddy, but also the epic line, the classic line, the bastard son of 100 maniacs, awesome stuff, like, but you had, and it was quite ambitious in its effects. I think it was Chuck Russell directed it, and it's got its moments, but the stop motion, skeleton that fights, you know, because it's his real bones, they have to try and uncover his real bones and bury them in hallowed ground to finish him off. But it's the kids, you know, in this psychiatric ward. Just, they're not convincing at all, and it's just too cheesy. It's totally too cheesy. And Craig Wasson, he's not believable as, you know, this highly qualified psychiatric, you know, doctor. And then, of course, Heather Langenkamp comes back. But because of their experiences, you know, she's this wunderkind, you know, so they bring it into this society. Say, oh, look, she's got genius in her. She knows what she's talking about. And then, you know, she gets sacked pretty much immediately because the minute she arrives, people start actually dying. But then you've got Wes Craven's New Nightmare, which was a great concept. Again, he breaks the wall. Scream was self-referential. So, with New Nightmare, way, way later on, he takes the conceit that Heather Langenkamp plays herself, Wes Craven plays himself, Rob Englund plays himself, and like the movies existed and they're doing a new one, but Freddy's influence, Freddy doesn't want to be killed off in the movies, he wants to stay alive. So his entity becomes a real thing. Yeah, it's hokey, but I remember at the time when it came out, I thought, that's genius, that. I really like that. But having watched it only recently, it doesn't hold up really that well. But the first movie, that was a rocketing whistle stop, you know, claw scratching tour through A Nightmare on Elm Street via finger knife glove and this rather lovely mask from Rubies. This is very cheap. I do recommend it actually. If you're a fan of Freddy Krueger, get the jersey. There are lots and lots of replica gloves. Some better than others, but none as good as that. If you can get someone, or if you can do it yourself, to make it yourself, then that would be the way forward. Because you want proper, you know, do you? Do you want proper metal claws, knives, which is sharp? You could do yourself a right mischief, you know. But you're lucky. My entrance on this video, I was gonna do it like I was in the bath, like Nancy, with the knees spread and the glove coming up. Chances are I would have framed that really badly and you'd have seen something even more horrific than a knife-fingered glove and a pizza-faced mask. Folks, gonna leave it there. Hope you enjoyed that little tour of Nightmare on Elm Street. Fire, mask, glove, music, Charles Bernstein's music. Go back and find the video on his music on the score, because it really showcased his talent something tremendous. In the meantime, sleep well, you know, sweet dreams. Make sure your dreams are all tartan. And I'm gonna see you all. Litters! One, two, Kilty's coming.